525,000 moments so dear. 525,600 minutes. How do you measure a year? In daylights, in sunsets, in midnights, in cups of coffee, in inches, in miles, in laughter, in strife. In 525,600 minutes. How do you measure a year in the life? How about love?
Minutes. 525,000 journeys to plan. 525,600 minutes. How do you measure the life of a woman or a man?
In truth that she learned, or in times that she cried, in bridges he burned, or the way that she died.
Easy. Hi, everybody. Hi. Well, welcome. Thank you all for coming tonight to the best little high school in Massachusetts. Yes. To hear from Senator Markey about the Green New Deal. Because, of course, this is the greenest little city in Massachusetts. And Senator Markey knows about this stuff. He really does. I would speculate that one of the most difficult parts of public life is being ahead of the curve, is advocating for issues and causes that aren't widely understood yet. And Senator Markey has been one of those kinds of leaders who was an environmentalist before there was a clearly defined environmental movement, and, you know, saw the dangers of the destabilization of our climate and has been looking for answers. So instead of, you know, just being mildly grateful to him for representing us year after year, I reckon we should all get strongly behind him and make sure he is reelected to the U.S. Senate. And my fellow members of the Somerville Legislative Delegation are here and are going to speak, and I'm going to give the mic next to Mike Connolly, state rep from East Somerville and East Cambridge.
All right. These mics are sometimes a little bit too short for me. How's everyone doing this evening? My name's Mike Connolly. I have the honor of representing East Somerville, Union Square, Assembly Row, and parts of Cambridge. And I'm so delighted to be here alongside Senator Markey and our Somerville colleagues in support of the Green New Deal. You know, I've been involved as an activist and now as an elected official for several years. And when I got started in activism, one of the most frustrating things that happened was when we would talk about climate, issues of economic justice would be pitted against climate justice. When we raised the issue of climate, issues of racial justice wouldn't be in the conversation. And what is so powerful about this Green New Deal is that it really takes an intersectional approach, and it says that we can address the climate crisis while at the same time pursuing economic justice, social justice, racial justice, and I think that's truly the way that we're going to move forward. What do you think? So thank you for being here. It's truly an honor to be here. And before I pass the mic to my colleague, Rep. Christine Barber, I'm not sure if she even introduced herself, but I want to just take a moment while we're standing on stage in front of all of you. 10 years ago, before I knew anything about the state legislature, the one thing I knew was that Denise Provo was an absolute progressive champion and the exact model for a state legislator. And so, as she recently announced that she'll be retiring at the end of this year from the Massachusetts House. So I think we should all give her a huge round of applause, Representative Denise Provo. And with that, I'm happy to pass it to my fellow Somerville colleague, Representative Christine Barber. Sorry, I had to do that.
That was great. Thanks, Mike. I want to thank all of you for coming here tonight. I am Christine Barber. I'm a state representative for parts of Somerville and also Medford. We have an incredible group of elected officials. A lot of our city councilors and school committee members are here joining us, and there'll be others speaking in a few minutes. But I really want to thank all of you. Somerville in particular has incredible activists who recognize what a climate emergency we are in, and I'm so thankful for all of the action that so many of you have taken. Senator Markey has been an incredible leader, we all know, on the Green New Deal. It's inspired us here at home to do everything that we can to make sure that Massachusetts is a leader. Some of my constituents who I worked with worked on a resolution for the Democratic, the state convention on doing a Green New Deal for Massachusetts. And I'm proud to be trying to take the work that's really inspired by and partnering with what Senator Markey is doing and trying to do that here in Massachusetts. We have an incredible group here, and I know there's so much more activism that we need to do, but that we can do together. So thank you all for coming. And with that, I want to introduce Mayor Joe Curtatone. Okay,
Good evening. Good evening. Welcome to the Centennial Auditorium here at Somerville High School, which we are where we seem to always be under construction. But we promise it will be over soon, especially to our students here and our staff and our teaching community. We are so excited to welcome all of you here, and especially welcome Senator Markey and my colleagues on the City Council, School Committee, and our state delegation. We truly have the most progressive leadership at all levels of government here in Somerville, and we're truly blessed. But I want to welcome all of you, especially our residents who have joined us, whether you live here in Somerville or you're visiting from a neighboring community. It's really encouraging to see so many people come out and talk about and listen to about the need to take action on climate change. It's also an honor that Senator Markey decided to hold his town hall here in Somerville, just as it really was an honor to have him make his Green New Deal announcement about a year ago here in Somerville over at Greentown Labs. In a time when this president and White House and fellow government is abdicating all responsibility on critical issues like climate change, we are all lucky to be represented by someone who takes this threat seriously. Not only does Senator Markey take climate change seriously, he has truly established himself as a leader on climate action with the bold Green New Deal resolution. The time of incremental small action steps on climate change is over. We need bold, systemic change in leadership. Addressing and mitigating climate change is going to require big changes and sacrifice. And we're going to have to shift away from a car culture that has swallowed us whole over the generations. We're going to have to aggressively pursue clean energy, and we're going to have to make sure workers are trained for jobs in the clean energy and clean tech sectors. Locally, we'll have to step up too. And we can't wait for this White House to be changed over and to realize how dire this is. In Somerville, we are truly blessed that I've been honored to serve with colleagues here on the City Council who have worked collaboratively and advocated for change, whether it's supporting our goal to be carbon neutral by 2050, or joining 9 other mayors across the Commonwealth to pledge to be truly committed to 100% renewables by 2045, our passing of new nationally recognized zoning that requires all new commercial buildings to be LEED Platinum, and so much more, shifting mobility culture away from the automobile into more biking, walking, and public transportation, building and planning a city for people and not cars. It's truly an honor to work with such progressive leadership and activism here in Somerville, Cambridge, and the region. We developed a climate forward plan that lays out how we can work to mitigate climate change and our contributions to it. It's kind of like our own local Green New Deal. And I know that regionally, again, many of my colleagues are thinking about how they can make their communities more resilient, prepare for the effects of climate change, and shrink their carbon footprints, truly instituting bold systemic change. As I mentioned, we're all, and I'd say some of us pretty lucky, both our state and federal delegations understand that we can no longer wait when it comes to climate change. It is truly an existential threat. And we're grateful to Senator Markey for leading the charge in Washington and pushing for federal government to do its part. So I'm excited to hear what he has to say tonight, like all of you. So please join me in welcoming our United States Senator, Ed Markey.
Can you give me that microphone up? All right. Is it on now? All right. Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you, Mayor Curtatone. You know, we're right here in Somerville, which is becoming a second green monster in Massachusetts. Just incredible leadership here in Somerville. The mayor and all the other leaders who are here today. Greentown, is really now becoming the symbol for Beantown. We have 100 companies, green energy companies here in Somerville over at Greentown, headquartered right here in Somerville. We have this all-star team of elected officials who have come here tonight. You already heard from Representative Mike Connolly. You heard from Representative Christine Barber. But let's give it up once again for your great state representative, Denise Provo, who's leaving. Denise just does a phenomenal job. We're going to miss her. Katiana Ballantyne is here from Somerville City Council. Ben Ewan Kappen is here. And Lance Davis is here. And Somerville School Committeeman Andre Green is here. We just have everyone who is making a difference, making a change here in Somerville, in Cambridge, in Medford, in Arlington. We are the leaders. We are Massachusetts. We have to go first. We're not just the Bay State. We are the brain state. We know we can do this. We know we can move to 100% green energy. We know we can do this. Now, I spent 2.5 weeks on the Senate floor listening to testimony about President Donald Trump and his use of $391 million of American taxpayer money to elicit an investigation of the Biden family from President Zelensky of the Ukraine. I heard it, I listened to it, and at the end of that process, last Wednesday, I stood twice when my name was called to vote guilty that Donald Trump had, in fact, committed an impeachable offense against our country. The damage he is doing, though, is profound, apart from that compromise of our national security. What he is doing to our planet by naming a coal lobbyist to head up the EPA, to name an oil lobbyist to run the Department of the Interior, to name an oil lobbyist to run the Department of Energy, is a crime against our country and the planet and all of the generations to come on our planet. And the budget which he just submitted this week slashes the budget of the EPA, slashes the budget of the Department of Energy, slashes the budget for energy research and new technologies in the United States of America. And by the way, zeroes out the National Endowment for the Arts. Can we give it up once again for all those young people who are up here singing? We don't want to zero out the arts. We want young people to be funded so that they can maximize their God-given abilities. So we thank you so much for coming out here tonight. We must be the leaders. So last year was the second warmest year ever recorded. We know that the planet is dangerously warming. And so just 1 year ago, I introduced with Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez the Green New Deal. 1 year. And in that 1 year, the Green New Deal has become not just a resolution, but it has become a revolution in our country, because young people joining the Sunrise Movement, joining 350, joining all of these environmental groups has now propelled the environment, propelled climate change into one of the top three issues that are being debated in our country. It was never there before, and it's never going to be any lower than it is right now, because the energy, the passion that young people are bringing to this issue is making it the generational issue, along with, by the way, gun safety, along with the issue of how these young people want us to finally make the NRA stand for not relevant anymore in American politics. But climate change goes right to the heart of the threat. And so what the Green New Deal says and does is pretty simple. It's only 14 pages long, and it lays out, number one, here's the science. The United Nations scientists say that by the year 2030, if we do not begin to take dramatic action, that we are facing an existential threat to the planet. Those are the words of the United Nations. In the same month, our own 13 federal agencies who were charged with reaching a conclusion about the impact that climate change would have on our own country came to the same conclusion. Their conclusion was that if we do not take action now, that by the year 2100, 80 years from now, the temperature will rise by 7 to 9 degrees Fahrenheit. 7 to 9 degrees. And we can see upwards of a 10-foot increase in sea level. For us, that would be that iceberg up on Greenland, 1,000 miles long, 300 miles wide, sitting on land. The ice on top of it is 1 to 2 miles high. That goes into the ocean. It's like putting a giant ice cube into a glass of already filled water. It's going to impact us from Cape Cod to Plum Island. It's going to impact us in Boston Harbor all the way in the Charles River. The Back Bay will return to its original personality before it got filled in the late 19th century. We know these things. We know it's true, not because of some anecdotal set of stories which are being told, but because our 13 federal agencies have told us this while serving for Donald Trump. Now, some of them might get marched out of their agencies by Donald Trump and his aides at some point in the next year. But this is something that's real, and it is happening now. The second part of it is there's a solution. The solution is to engage in a massive technological deployment of technologies which largely already exist. In the year 2008, we had a grand total of 2,000 megawatts of solar in the United States. 2,000, beginning of time, 2008, 2,000. We began to change policies at the federal, state, and local level, tax incentives. As of December 31st, 2019, we're up to 78,000 megawatts of solar. And that's with Donald Trump and red state governors fighting it the whole way. On wind, we had 25,000 megawatts of wind by 2008. By the end of 2019, we were up to 110,000 megawatts of wind, and that's with Donald Trump's Department of Interior killing the wind project off of the Massachusetts coast. That's with governors trying hard in red states to slow down the wind revolution. In 2008, pick a number in your brain. How many all-electric vehicles were there in the United States in 2008? Pick a number in your brain. You're wrong. 2,000 total in 2008, all-electric vehicles. But then we changed some of the tax incentives. We actually, through that stimulus fund that we had to put in place after George Bush created that recession, we actually helped to save Tesla. It was going under. So just in 2019, we sold 330,000 new electric vehicles, and it's going up to 400,000 in 2020. That's up from only 2,000 total in the whole history of electric vehicles by 2008. So that's a victory for us. But it's only a fraction of what can happen if we had real federal policy, if we had tax incentives and regulatory policy in every single state that matched the magnitude of the problem. We can do this. The third part of the bill was something that Alexandria and I decided that we would include. And that was hearkening back to Franklin Delano Roosevelt's 1944 State of the Union Address, where what he did in that address is he called for a second Bill of Rights for Americans, because there were going to be 11 million veterans returning from World War II. And on top of the first Bill of Rights, he said, we need a second one, that everyone is entitled to a job. Everyone is entitled to education. Everyone is entitled to health care. It's written into his State of the Union Address in 1944. And what we added, Alexandria and I, is that this second New Deal, the Green New Deal, should be done with frontline communities in mind, with minority groups in mind, with intersectionality in mind, that we make sure that those communities who got left behind over the last century are at the front of the line being included. Because we know that these polluting facilities most often are put in the most vulnerable and politically powerless communities. And we also know that black and brown Americans breathe different air than white Americans breathe. We know this. So we built that in to the Green New Deal. And we said that we can create millions of new jobs, union jobs, good paying jobs, and that everyone should be able to line up in order to deploy this new generation of energy technologies for our country. In the same way that we moved the world in the 1990s, we moved the world from flip phones that no one had until 1996. This is when people started to have flip phones, huh? 1993, 94, 95, 96. The world didn't have them. We didn't have them. But within 10 years, in the United States, because of our innovation, because we broke down the barriers to entry, everyone was walking around with a computer in their pocket, the same power as the computer on the Apollo mission. And now in Africa, there's 500 million people walking around with a computer with the power of the Apollo mission, because the United States went first, because the United States innovated, because the United States said, no, we are not going to be tied to technologies of the past. We are going to look to the future. And so to match this wireless revolution that goes on around the world, we have to give those communities, not just in the United States, but in Africa, in South America, in Asia, we have to give them the new technologies. We have to discover them, invent them, deploy them, lower the price of them, and then disseminate them across the planet. Now, what's the response from Donald Trump? Donald Trump and Fox News, every single night, and by the way, Fox News gives a lot more attention to this issue than does MSNBC or CNN. They hate this idea. They hate it. They cover it over and over again. You want to know why? So they can call it socialism. They call it socialism night after night on Fox TV. And you know what I say to them? What do you call 100 years of tax breaks for the oil, gas, and coal industry uninterrupted? It looks like socialism to me, taking money from ordinary families and giving it to the wealthiest industries in the world. And give us some of that socialism for wind and solar and all electric vehicles and storage technologies and all electric buildings, and we will bury the fossil fuel industry within a generation. We know this will happen. We know it will happen. So this is the challenge of the Green New Deal. This is the challenge which is being presented to us in the last year of Donald Trump's presidency. It is for us to make sure that he is not successful in ensuring that climate change is an existential threat to our planet. Because, let's be honest, a second term for Donald Trump is a death sentence for the planet. Because if we do not act for 8 consecutive years, the Chinese will sit on the sidelines. India will sit on the sidelines. Because you can't preach temperance from a bar stool. You can't tell the rest of the world to reduce their greenhouse gas emissions if you're not doing it yourself. You can't tell a kid not to drink or smoke if you're telling them with a cigar in your hand and a beer. They're not going to take it seriously. And that's where we are with Donald Trump. That's where we are with this man. Now, we have indications that within 20 years, Mar-a-Lago will turn into Mar-a-Lagoon because of where it is. But he says to himself, he says, I'll be able to build a wall around my place, but everybody else can't build a wall around their place, huh? They won't be able to protect themselves from what's coming inevitably, to not just Massachusetts, not just Florida, but to the entire planet. So this is the national security, economic, environmental, and healthcare and moral issue of our time. Our own generals and admirals say that climate change is a threat multiplier, that there could be 200 million climate refugees by the year 2050. And that will force the United States to be deploying more troops, more military personnel, more resources all around the world, because we'll be the responsible party. We'll have to be there. Boundaries, global boundaries, will just be disappearing. And the consequences will be great. And this Donald Trump is lowering the number of refugees he wants to accept in our country while creating millions more, tens of millions more, that will be looking for a place to go when climate change devastates where they live right now. So we have this incredible moment as a country, and it is to stand up and to fight, because this is perhaps our last moment to really make a difference. And if those tides are coming across Faneuil Hall, hitting it on the side, if Cape Cod is being destroyed, if Plum Island up in Newburyport is gone, the least that we should be able to say is that we tried. We really tried to avoid that catastrophe. Huh? This is the time, this is the place, we are the people who have to do this. And we have allies, the Sunrise Movement. We have allies, we have this incredible movement that is out there that is ready in 2020 to make a difference. So I thank all of you for coming out, and it's my honor, you know, to be here with the mayor, our great mayor, and all of the wonderful city councilors, school committee, state representatives who are here this evening. They are all great leaders, and up in the state house, they lead, they're moving legislation that's the most progressive in the whole country and trying to make us the leader. But we're going to have to just do more to lift our voices, to lift our action to a much, much higher level. So I think I can stop right there if you want. And I don't know, Christina, we're out. Christine Barber over here has questions that you have been gracious enough to fill out. And maybe, Christine, you could read some of those questions and I will try to answer them, because they've come from, and coming up the middle aisle like it's the Oscars, our great state senator, Pat Jaylen, is here. So we thank you, Senator, for coming this evening. We very much appreciate it. You were in session. Well, so at this point in time, I'm going to ask Senator Pat Jaylen to make her acceptance speech on the work you're doing on climate science, climate change, up in the State House. And all the other state representatives have spoken. I'd love to have you come over and just say a few words if you would like to. We would love to have you say just a few words, if you would. You're welcome.
I actually don't want to talk about climate change. All these people want to talk about climate change. I want to talk about how, when we're in a terrible situation, we get depressed and we take little steps and we fight back. But other times, in the first New Deal, people looked big and they transformed the American economy by empowering labor unions, by increasing the minimum wage, by putting people to work on public works jobs. And if you want a more recent example of somebody who thought big, think, you can't call it the war on climate, but think about the war on poverty and the first year that Lyndon Johnson was president. Medicaid, oh, I forgot, Social Security, transformative. So in the first New Deal, but in Lyndon Johnson's first year, Medicaid increased the minimum wage, first federal aid to public education, Head Start. I could go on and on. And that's, to me, what the Green New Deal is. It's thinking big in bad times. So the one thing I know from history is things will change, and it's up to us to change them. So we need leaders like this to help us figure out what those changes will be.
Thank you, Pat. Woo. Thank you. Wow. And Pat is right. We cannot agonize. We must organize, okay? It's like, this is our time. We are at one of those inflection points in history. Donald Trump is running for re-election. It's an inflection point in the history of our country. And it's not just for climate. It's for healthcare. He'll destroy the healthcare system. In this budget he's just proposed, he eviscerates Medicaid, the Department of Education, the EPA, agency after agency, just an evisceration of each and every one of those agencies. Don't worry, though, he increased the budget for the Defense Department and for Homeland Security, but everything else just slashed, right? And so it's almost an ancient animosity that he and Republicans harbor towards Medicare and Medicaid and minimum wage legislation, that in the Trump era they get a chance to act out, and if they got the extra votes, would ultimately implement. So that's absolutely, Senator, where we are, and we have to match the historical moment that we are being challenged to respond to. So Representative Barber.
Thank you. First, how lucky are we to have Ed Markey as our senator? Let's give him another round of applause for his work. So the senator would like to take some questions, and I want to thank all of you who submitted questions out front when you came in. So the way we're going to do this is we have two staff. We have Carly and Nolan who have mics, and I'm going to call a few names. When I call your name, I want you to come up the aisle. If you're not able to stand up and come to the aisle, wave, and our staffers will come to you with a mic, and we will ask you to ask your questions to the senator. So I'm going to start, I'll read
the By the way, Carly is a graduate of Somerville High School on my staff, just so you know this, right?
So I'm going to call the first three names, so when you hear your name, come up and start to come forward, and we'll go through some of the questions. So first, we have Sarah, Todd, and Caroline from Cambridge. Then we're going to have Kenya Arbiza from Somerville Teen Empowerment, and Paul from Somerville Climate Coalition of Somerville.
And could you identify yourself, please?
My name is Paul Dworkin. I represent the Climate Coalition of Somerville, which is an organization of different climate organizations in this area. My question is particular. Mm-hmm. Many people use what they claim are flaws in the Green New Deal as an excuse not to support it. What do we say to them to convince them when there is nothing else being proposed? They are using this as an excuse to do nothing, and how do we convince them that it's better to improve something than to not act?
Well, what you say first is infallibility is a very elusive human quality, okay? So, what I would say is this. The boldness of the Green New Deal matches the magnitude of the problem.
And what we did in this resolution was to lay out what should happen in manufacturing, in automotive, in housing, in every sector of the American economy, because they can all be transformed with new technologies, with new strategies, with new conservation techniques. They can all be improved dramatically and in a very brief period of time. That's why I pulled out the iPhone. You know, you have to basically, a kid today believes that a 50-inch HD interactive screen with their wireless device on their lap is a constitutional right, and it didn't even exist 15 years ago, any of this stuff. So we can do it. I think there's a pessimism, a technological pessimism, which is at the heart of some of these skeptics. They don't believe we can do it. But honestly, the Green New Deal really captures the ambition of the moonshot with the moral imperative of the Civil Rights Act of 1965. And it challenges this generation to respond. People didn't think we could reach the moon. People didn't think we could transform our country with that Civil Rights Act. But that's what we're saying here. We can do both. We can have this technological revolution, and we can do it with intersectionality. We can do it with frontline communities. We can do it with minority communities, all fully involved right from the very beginning. So I guess my answer to them is, what do you have?
Yes.
Our scientists say that sea rise is going to be 7 to 9 feet in the next 80 years. The UN says we only have until 2030. To take dramatic action. What's your plan? What would you do? What are the changes you would make? And you know what they're gonna say? I don't know. I don't have a plan. Well, guess what? That's what the Green New Deal is. And what it says is, in each and every category, let's just begin the revolution. You know, we put that mission to the moon in a decade. But if it had gone 2 more years and it was 1972, would we say, oh, it was a failure? No, we would not. Because they went on the mission, they completed it. Because they set the goals to 100%, they met it. And so when we say 100% clean energy, that's the goal. And we'll come very close to, if not meeting that goal, if we set it as Americans. But we have to accept the science. The denier-in-chief sits in the Oval Office. And if people don't rise up to meet this historic moment in time, then we are going to fail. And failure is not an option. So my answer to them is, what's your plan? And the Republicans keep saying that on the Senate floor, okay? They keep saying the Green New Deal, socialism. And you know what we say to them? What's your, do you believe the science? We say to them. No, no, no. Do you believe the science? No, no, no. Do you believe the science? Do you believe our own scientists? 2100, rise to 7 to 10 feet, temperature, 7 to 10 degrees. Do you believe that or not? And if you do, what's your plan? And so we've forced them now to accept the science. And now they're saying, but now we can't do it. All right? And we're saying, yes, you can. Yes, you can. We can have smart grids. We can have solar and wind. We can have new agricultural no-till policies. We can reforest large parts of America. We can stop the worst, most dangerous polluting. We can stop the Weymouth Station from being constructed to bring natural gas up to Maine. We can do these things. We can be the leaders here in Massachusetts and across the rest of the planet. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Senator.
Question over here, back over here, yes. Who are you, sir?
Okay. Hi, my name's Todd Rogers. I live in Cambridge. I'm a dad of two amazing kids, and I'm standing here. I have a question about my powerful activist 10-year-old daughter. What can she do to advance the new Green Deal starting tomorrow morning?
First thing I would do is I would sign her up for Sunrise. I would take her over to Sunrise headquarters. Yep. I'd have her be introduced to all these young people who are working every single day. And I'd be challenging her to organize her own sunrise movement in her fifth grade, okay? So that she's the leader in the fifth grade, and that then she starts to ask questions about how energy efficient her school is, what's the goal for putting solar panels on the roof of that school? What's the plan? Sign her up for the Sunrise Movement. Okay. They'll give her the 10-point program immediately, and she'll start, you know, as an activist, you know, with an agenda, and she'll sign up all of the rest of these young people who are looking, you know, young people are looking for the answers. If you give it to them, they'll go out and work on it. You know, they want to hear the words from adults, you know, and they want to hear the words from older young people. But if you give it to them, they will act on it, right? And that's the leadership that she can then provide within her own classroom, amongst her own friends, and then that will spread throughout the entire school, right? In terms of that becoming the greenest school in Massachusetts, okay? Because of her leadership. So tell her if she needs help, I'm on her side. Call me. What's her name?
I told her I wouldn't say her name, but let's just say that it's
it's
a name that rhymes with Cheryline.
Cheryline. All right.
Thank you, Sam.
Tell her. Tell her I will partner with her. All right. Good. Yes.
Good evening, everyone. My name's Kenya Arbiza. I'm a proud Somerville High graduate. Beautiful. I graduated last year with the class of 2019.
Is it Kenya?
Yes.
Kenya.
I'm the daughter of immigrants from El Salvador. El Salvador is currently the second most deforested country in Central America behind Haiti, which is a lot of where my friends and their families are from, El Salvador and Haiti, here in Somerville. And I just want to take this moment to acknowledge the harm that putting profits over people causes. I am lucky to be here in a country where I won't be murdered for being a climate activist. And I want to ask you, Senator, and this audience, who is predominantly white, what are you doing to create a space that guarantees justice for my community? And what are you doing to amplify those voices rather than giving us empty promises?
Right, well, that is exactly what Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and I did in that bill. So right after the election in 2018, I called her up. And she's of Puerto Rican, you know, descent. And so I called her, I said, let's have lunch. I said, let's sit down. Let's talk about the Green New Deal. Let's talk about doing it together. Let's put it together in a way that deals with the science, deals with the technologies that can solve the problem, and deals with the social equity in our society. So that's how we wrote it. We wrote it including and saying the words frontline communities, minority communities, saying the words intersectionality in the Green New Deal, so that everyone is included. And the Sunrise Movement is populated in the same way that the Green New Deal would like to see it be implemented. It's young people of all nationalities. The woman who founded it is from here. She lives in East Boston. She went to Axton-Boxborough High School. She is of Indian descent, and she founded this, created it. Right? And we can do more even here. But on the question of your country, of the country of where your parents are from, I went to Salvador several times, completely corrupt government that we were backing in the 1980s, in the 1990s. We were providing the funding for. We were creating the conditions that led to where we are today. We were backing American corporations who had no concern for the environment of those countries. And one of the things the United States has to do now, finally, is own our own history in these countries, in El Salvador, in Guatemala, in Nicaragua, and all of the rest. We have to own our own history. So that's part of what the Green New Deal is all about. It's talking not just about big corporations being given grants to solve the problem, it's saying explicitly it must be done with frontline communities. It must be done with minorities at the front of the line. It must be union jobs that are central to making sure this job gets done in our society. And that apprenticeship programs, that entry-level programs are welcoming minorities, welcoming people of every nationality into it. So that's really the heart of the Green New Deal, okay? And that's the promise of it. If we are successful in 2020 in getting rid of Donald Trump, flipping the Senate to Democrat, giving Nancy Pelosi more seats in the House of Representatives, then we're off and running in January of 2021, implementing a vision of a better country. So thank you so much, Kenya. Thank you for being
thank
here.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to call up a few more people to ask their questions. So we have George from the Somerville Bicycle Safety Group. And when I call you, come forward or raise your hand and we'll come to you. Amanda Lewis from Somerville and Daniel Najmi from Malden.
So come on up to the microphones on either side. And if you could, just please introduce yourself.
Oh, thank you. Hi, I'm Amanda Lewis. I'm a resident of Somerville. I'm here with my mom.
Beautiful.
We both love what you're doing, and thank you so much. My question was about reaching across the aisle. How do you explain this to your Republican colleagues? Is the tide changing? Because I know that this idea has been has been around for maybe a year. Are you getting anywhere?
Right now, the Republican Party is in a vice-like grip of the fossil fuel industry. And Donald Trump and Mitch McConnell from Kentucky are the leaders of their party. There are a lot of Republicans who know that the science is real. Republicans who want to move and begin to do something that's more than just nominal. But they're controlled from the top down. That's their biggest source of money. That goes into the Republican Party, comes out of this fossil fuel sector. You know, and I've taken a pledge that I'm not taking any money from any fossil fuel industry whatsoever. So I am actually, I'm hopeful, to be honest with you, that if we could get rid of Donald Trump, if we could flip the Senate so Democrats control and we have a chance to do so, that there will be Republicans who will cross over, finally, and say, let us work together. There was one Republican yesterday, I saw it in the front page of the paper yesterday, who is proposing a tax on every vehicle mile driven, which runs totally contrary to Republican philosophy. But at a minimum, it indicates people are thinking about what would their solution be to solve the problem and then to take that money and to put it into clean energy technologies or into other problems that have to be solved in our society. So I am hopeful that what Mitt Romney did last week, believe me, there were 10 more that knew that what he did was wrong and a high crime. They knew it. And the same thing is true on climate science. They know the science is real. But we just have to, this year, make this 1932. Herbert Hoover's got to go. Make this the year where we allow the New Deal, the Green New Deal, to be implemented. And if we have that revolution politically, then I think Republicans will cross over. They will join with us. We will have tax policy and regulatory policy that ultimately creates a telescope time frame. So I would not be in this business. For example, in 2007, we controlled the House and we controlled the Senate. And so my proposal was to increase fuel economy standards from where they had been since 1975, 27 miles per gallon, but we had to change the law. And it took me the whole year. Ultimately, I had to work with Republicans, and that became a law. And that's the law that Barack Obama used to lift the fuel economy standards to 54.5 miles per gallon that Donald Trump is now trying to roll back. But we can do this. And what I'm saying is that when opportunity arises politically because you've been successful at the ballot box, which is this year, then policy opportunities then present themselves. And that's what happened in 2007. Earlier, I was able to pass an appliance efficiency law that led to hundreds of coal-burning plants never having to be built because the air conditioning that now is used here is twice as efficient as it used to be, and as a result, you need half the electricity And the same thing is true for refrigerators, and the same thing is true for stoves. Well, that's a law I got passed, right? But I couldn't do it without finding Republicans who would cross over to do that. And ultimately, that's all these greenhouse gases are. They're the collective demand of all these products that we use. Air conditioning, lighting, automobiles. And if we keep doubling their efficiency and doubling them again and doubling them again, then ultimately, you know, we're going to see the solution. And I think we have a real chance, to be honest with you. If we get rid of Trump, we have a chance to work with Republicans to do it. The Chamber of Commerce, Procter & Gamble, BP just announced yesterday that they want to move towards zero net emissions by 2050 for their own corporation. We'd have to hold them to that, make them accountable. But we're beginning to win. Okay, we're beginning to see the cracks in the unity that existed because the science is now irrefutable. So I'm really optimistic that there are Republicans that we will be able to find, but it's only going to be after we get rid of Donald Trump, because you could see last week on the Senate floor on a clear and compelling case of a crime against our country how uniform they stick with him, notwithstanding the overwhelming evidence. So that's why this election is so important. This is the Herbert Hoover election. This is the Richard Nixon election. This is the moment where we have to win, but we can do it. We can do it. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator, for being here. My name is Danielle Najmi. I'm from Malden, your hometown.
Beautiful.
And I wanted to ask about nuclear energy. I've heard some people say that the fastest way for us to get off fossil fuels would be to invest in nuclear energy, because solar and wind maybe haven't produced enough power right now to meet all the demand we have. But I'm not sure about that. So I wanted to hear, what does the science say, and what have the Green New Deal say on that?
On nuclear, yeah. Well, thank you. I am from Malden. I live in the same house that I grew up in. And people say, how did you become an environmentalist? When did that start? Well, it started when I was a kid. And the Malden River was 4 blocks from my house. It's still 4 blocks from my house. I live in the same house. But the Malden River, because the coal companies, the chemical companies just used it as a sewer, had kind of this purple haze on it. You know, it looked black for most of the time. And my mother said to me, whatever you do, Eddie, you and your brothers, don't swim in the Malden River. Well, if you're a kid and the river's 4 blocks away, you know, and you just read Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn, that's your big adventure. But she's saying, don't swim in the Malden River. And I can still see that purple haze. Well, we cleaned it up. Now, I've been able to help to accomplish that goal as a congressman and a senator. But it's something that each one of us has our own example of what it was that turned us into an environmentalist. That was me in Malden. Nuclear power. Nuclear power provides 19% of all electricity in the United States right now. And at the same time, there hasn't been a new nuclear power plant successfully ordered for a long, long time in our country. And one of the reasons is the collapse of the price of wind and solar and energy efficiency, and the dramatic increase in the cost of building a nuclear power plant. So there are 2 nuclear power plants under construction right now in Georgia, the Vogtle plants they're called. They were supposed to cost $12 billion between the two of them, producing 2,200 megawatts of electricity. You know how I told you we're up to 75,000 megawatts of solar now, and up to 110,000 megawatts of wind? Well, those 2 power plants are supposed to produce 2,200 megawatts. And they've been delayed 1 year, and 2 years, and 5 years, and 7 years, and now the cost is up to $27 billion for those 2 power plants, and it's still 5 more years to go, so it'll go well over $30 billion. So I asked my staff just to take $27 billion and tell me how much electricity we could generate from solar right now and install it all in the next year in the United States. And it's 6,500 megawatts of solar at existing prices that we'd get for the $27 billion. So if you're a CEO of a utility across the country and you look at that, you look at Georgia, and you can't get a more favorable regulatory environment than Georgia and the Public Utility Commission of Georgia, I will tell you that much, okay? And they can't get it built. And it's more than double the cost than it was when it was being planned. Well, it's highly unlikely that we're going to see people investing when they can move to renewables, when they can move to energy efficiency. It just is highly unlikely that that is going to happen. So we don't rule out nuclear in the Green New Deal, but it has to compete in the marketplace. And all we're saying is give the same tax breaks to wind and solar, give the same tax breaks to energy efficiency, and then get out of the way and watch the market work as it is already. So for those who'd say wind and solar can't play a big role, yeah, that was true in 2008 because we had terrible tax and regulatory policy. But now we have 35 times more solar than we had back then. Now we have 5 times as much wind as we had back then because we changed the policy, and there's no limit to how high they can go if we create a new smart grid in our country. And so I guess what I would say to you is, in many ways, Adam Smith, in his grave, is looking at nuclear power plant and saying nuclear power and just saying it's met its maker in the marketplace. But it's not a bunch of granola chomping liberals, you know, hugging trees that killed it. It's Wall Street that has killed it because they won't give them the money any longer for any new nuclear power plants in our country. So that would be my answer to you, and thank you so much for asking the question. Thank you. Yeah.
Before we get to the next question, I want to quickly call a few more people up. So May from Somerville and Paul from Cambridge, you're on deck. Come on up.
Hello. I'm with a group called Somerville Bicycle Safety, which advocates for a network of protected bike lanes in Somerville. So, and in particular, I want to thank Mayor Curtitone for putting bus lanes and protected bike lanes on Broadway. So this is a local decision because these are local streets. On a state level, you have things like gas taxes. So my question is, in general, how does the Green New Deal work with states and with local governments in order, because every level of government has a decision to play with regards to climate change?
Yeah, thank you. So my view would be that in any transportation bill that passes the United States Congress, that we have to have a smart streets component, that we have to be saying to ourselves, how do we make sure we've integrated biking and pedestrians, and how do we make sure that we're making it easier for all electric vehicles to have charging stations that make it easier for them to be able to fully participate in an economy? And so bike lanes, but the incentives in the national federal budget, and we actually have a bill that is going through right now that I've included language on smart streets so that local communities will have access to money that can help them to accomplish that goal. I think it has to come from the federal government and the state and the local government. So when Somerville moves in that direction, that there are federal monies that they can tap into that help them to become the models for the rest of the country. But I think it's inevitable that we move deeper and deeper into that direction because that's where younger people especially want to be. They want to live in cities, they want to be able to move around easily, and in the more that we invest in the transportation pathways that make that possible, is the sooner we're going to get there. So that's what I'm on the infrastructure committee. And Donald Trump is promising he's going to have a big infrastructure bill. Big. We have the worst roads, the worst bridges. We have the worst airports in the world. So he said that 3 years ago. And I put myself on the infrastructure committee waiting for the big bill. And part of the big bill will be I'm going to write in the language on what you're talking about to make sure that that bikes and other modes of transportation are fully included. So thank you, sir, so much. And thank you for that question. By the way, we're joined by Brianna Lungo-Curran, who is over here, the new mayor, the new great mayor of Medford, has joined us this evening. So thank you so much for being here tonight. Next question. Yes, sir.
Hi, Senator Markey. I'm Paul from Cambridge. I believe I'm the right Paul. And the question I had is, I know, as you've pointed out, the Green New Deal proposal bill is only a year old. You've made tremendous strides, but still, I look at the current campaigns in 2020 for the upcoming November elections, and I'm a bit surprised that the environment and the Green New Deal aren't even more seen as winning issues in this election, especially, I mean, the potential for increasing voter turnout, especially among younger voters, seems enormous, and it seems to me it should be even more of a big deal than it is right now. And maybe you can speak to what you see as the obstacles or the way forward to make it more of a winning issue.
No, I agree with you on the one hand. On the other hand, just remember that in 2016, not one reporter asked Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump a question about climate change. Mm-hmm. Not one question of Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. Well, the Green New Deal has solved that problem, okay, in terms of the 2020 cycle. And for many of those debates, there was a climate change question, there was a Green New Deal question, and they were all raising their hands. There was one debate when they were all asked, what is the number one issue? And at that point, there were 10 of them up there, and 8 of them said that climate change or the Green New Deal was their number one issue, right? So that's only 2 months ago or 3 months ago. That's how telescoped the time frame is on this presidential debate, that December seems like ancient history already. But the truth is that on college campuses all across Iowa and in New Hampshire, that climate activists were picking amongst those candidates that they thought were going to advance this agenda the most. And every time I was up there for Elizabeth, who I'm backing, I would include it every time. And the response was always just like that. So it's a very real issue in a way that it hasn't been in the past. And I actually think as we move along and we hit California, and we hit other states and all the candidates are there, that we're going to hear this like in an echo chamber. We're going to hear people just making it clear that they are going to ensure that the federal government leads on these issues. For example, LA now has an LA Green New Deal. The mayor has signed it, okay? Taking the name of the Green New Deal and then putting together a comprehensive plan for the city of LA. So I think as this campaign goes on, we're only 2% of the way through this campaign, and it hits state after state, I think you're going to hear more and more about the Green New Deal and more about climate change, because it's a voting issue, and there are activists out there waiting to hear in each one of those states which direction they should go in and give their energy and their enthusiasm in the 2020 election. So I'm optimistic about that. Thank you, sir. Much appreciated. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, everyone. My name is Dr. Megan Brady. I'm a physical therapist. Thank you, Senator Ed Markey, for speaking to us tonight about the Green New Deal. This is a preventive measure. We know that walkable communities, on average, constituents and our patients weigh about 10 pounds less on average in walkable communities. This issue is big. It's huge, as they say. Physical therapy is and movement is a way to keep people healthy and to keep them moving. And I have to thank you, Senator Ed Markey and Senator Elizabeth Warren, for supporting physical therapy in underserved areas. So let's give them a round of applause for supporting movement in these areas, adding us to the National Health Service Corps. My question for you, Senator Ed Markey, is physical therapy is being limited by Medicare. We have 8% cuts coming through. What can we do with the APTA to work towards increasing these preventive measures for healthier, more walkable, and movement-friendly communities?
And, I'm with you. And right here thank on my you. Shirt, if you wonder what that was, this is my Fitbit, and
I've got to get in 10,000 steps, 5 miles a day. So I've just. It serves here like a guilty conscience on me all day long, and there are many nights when I just walk up and down the street in Malden, no matter how cold it is, so I can cross 10,000 and feel good about myself. So, and I'm married to a physician who was Assistant Surgeon General of the United States and retired as a 2-star admiral in the Public Health Service of the United States of America, and you know what I learned from her? An ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. And that the more that we engage in preventative activities that help to avoid the kinds of healthcare conditions that otherwise will be created, is the smarter we are and how much more we're gonna save the entire healthcare system. Because we've been running a sick care system, not a healthcare system in our country for 100 years. And you have to move the whole direction of the healthcare system over towards physical therapy and other other approaches that ultimately are less expensive in the long run because you've made it easier for people to take care of themselves. We've cured most of the diseases that our parents and grandparents died from. And now we suffer from the diseases we give ourselves. Okay? It's obesity, drinking, drugs, you name it. It's things that we do to ourselves. And how do you deal with those? It's prevention, right? It's putting in place the preventative programs. We need to do that for the opioid crisis, but we need to do that as well here in physical therapy, and I'm with you 1,000%. It should not be cut. I will make sure it doesn't get cut. We need to increase it, make it a bigger part of the healthcare system in our country. Yes, thank you. Appreciate it.
Okay, we have time for a couple more questions. I'm going to call up another group. David Walker from Medford. I think it's Jay Storism from Cambridge and Nafis Hassan from Boston.
Yeah. By the way, as you come up, I mentioned one Somerville High School graduate who is on my staff, but I have a second Somerville High School graduate, Nancy Alfonso, right here, who is on my staff as well. So, high quality. Right over here, yes, sir. Can you identify yourself, please?
Yeah. Hi, my name is David Walker. I'm from Medford. I was really happy to hear what Mayor Curtone said about what they're doing in Somerville. About creating cities for people and not just for cars. So my question for you, Senator, is will you oppose the cuts to Amtrak's funding that the president has proposed?
Oh, my God.
And also, will you fight for federal funding for major green infrastructure transportation projects here in Boston, like especially like the North-South Rail Link?
Yeah. So here's my goal. Here's my goal, okay? Yeah, it's not to see any cuts in Amtrak, one. See dramatic increases in funding for Amtrak. Turn it into high-speed rail. Connect North Station to South Station. Make it easier to go from Boston out to Springfield and out even further west. To have it easier to go down to the South Coast, down to New Bedford and Fall River, so that they're connected by rail. To have the funding that makes that possible, because let's be honest, for a lot of young people, it's getting awful expensive to live here. But if they could get on a train and just, you know, be in another place in 35, 40, 50 minutes, they'd go and do that and have affordable housing and then come up here to work every single day. We know that's the case. We just have to work. My mother used to say, when she was really angry with me, my mother would say, Eddie, when I was 10 or 11, she said, Eddie, you have to learn how to work smarter and not harder. Your father and I, we're going to donate your brain to Harvard Medical School as a completely unused human organ. So here we have a whole generation of young people don't want to have their own cars. They want to be able to get around without them. We know that if we invested in Amtrak, if we invested in rail out west, down south, that the housing is there, that young people would be able to take advantage of it, and so I'm waiting and really hoping and wishing that he proposes a trillion dollar infrastructure bill as he's proposed, because we would get 20 billion of that, and then we could earmark it for all of these projects that go right to using transportation modes that dramatically reduce, if not eliminate, the carbon footprint and deal with housing shortages, deal with economic growth that should happen in other parts of the state as well. So I thank you for that question. And the reason I know it's important was my father worked for the Hood Mill Company. My father drove a truck for the Hood Mill Company in Charlestown. And we didn't have a car until I was 10 years old. So my father had to go up to the Fellsway to get on the bus to go to Sullivan, to then go over to Charlestown. So we didn't have a car when I was growing up. We needed to use it was called the MTA at the time, not the MBTA. And I knew how important it was to my family, and it's equally important today to newcomers to our country, to young people who want to move in that direction in terms of the transportation mode for their lives. And that's why If there's anything I'm going to do with the president this year that's going to be bipartisan, it's going to be a transportation bill. We're going to make sure it's a green transportation bill, that it doesn't just put a white line down the middle of America and pave it over, but rather implements a transportation strategy that is green and also deals with the transportation challenges of the 21st century. So I thank you, sir, so much for that question. And over here, please.
Hi, my name is Jay, and I want to echo what some of the previous questioners have said about transportation and housing. And as I'm sure that you're aware, all of this is connected, right? So there's no affordable housing in Cambridge means I have to move out to Worcester and drive every day to work, and that increases carbon emissions. And so one of the solutions is to create affordable housing, denser affordable housing, in places that people want to live. And that's really maybe one of our biggest tools in our arsenal. But an issue is in local communities, local people have so much control and pushback over what gets built and what doesn't, regardless of whether or not the federal money is there. Mm-hmm. Of course, it helps. So what is the plan, I guess, at the larger federal level to kind of move away from the individual, people approve or disapprove project by project basis and actually get real affordable dense housing in the
excellent.
Area?
Well, and that's a great question. So Mayor Curtatone, Mayor Walsh, Medford, 15 communities, the cities that are right here inside of Route 128 have all come together to put together a plan to build 165,000 new affordable homes by the year 2030 inside of those 15 communities, which is incredible leadership. But they're going to need some help ultimately. So Elizabeth Warren has introduced legislation that I'm co-sponsor of that will help to fund 3 million new affordable homes in our country. That will ultimately help to put a cap on the rise in the price of housing for people. But we're going to have to spend the money, because a vision without funding is an hallucination, right? You have to have a plan. You have to have a funding mechanism. So to the extent to which, you put your finger right on it, there is a housing crisis, and it's very real. And I'm already seeing it in Malden, because it hit Somerville, it hit Cambridge. Now it's hitting Malden. And there's a skyrocketing cost for housing in Malden that I'm living with right now. So I see it, and I know that we have to pass federal legislation. That's why, with Elizabeth, I've introduced that legislation. And I think that once we get Trump out of the way, then we will have a real housing policy in this country. Because if you kick Donald Trump in the heart, you're going to break your toe. There's not going to be a housing policy that deals with the types of people who are looking for a real change. But I agree with you. Transportation and housing are right at the heart of what we have to do. And a lot of these things just can't be solved without additional help. If you take what just happened in Massachusetts, for example, in terms of adding $1.5 billion to the education budget that's going to go to the schools and the kids that need it the most, that's Massachusetts being the brain state, right? You got to invest in these young kids who are coming up right now who might not have all the advantages in life, but their brains are just as strong as any preceding generation of young people in our country's history. And that's the kind of model we actually need for the whole country. We need a national education policy, right, that reflects how we in our own state try hard on education. We were the inventors of the Affordable Care Act here. And even with that, we're not happy with our education system. We're not happy with our healthcare system. But we're ahead of everyone else, and we're still not happy with ourselves. That's who we are. We're Massachusetts. And we have to take that attitude and bring it over to housing and bring it over to transportation, because we can't be the laggards. We have to be the leaders on those issues. We have to show that we can do it. And I thank you for that. But when Elizabeth's president and being sworn in, I can promise you, it'll be part of the inaugural address. Yes, sir. Over here. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Nafis. I have a question. So you've answered questions about housing and transportation. I have one about energy. So in Massachusetts in the last year in the last 2 years, we have seen the utility companies, the investor-owned utilities like National Grid, Eversource, You know, Eversource is trying to build an electric substation in a flood zone in an environmental justice community in East Boston. Mm-hmm. Columbia Gas blew up Lawrence. And on the West Coast, you're seeing Pacific Gas and Electric burning down millions of homes and destroying a whole town. And my question to you is, in your Green New Deal, do you support public ownership of utilities? Or would you bring existing utilities under public ownership?
What I believe is that we have to ensure that the utilities implement the public policies that we want to see them put in place. So my father grew up in Lawrence. My father grew up in the first floor of a triple decker in South Lawrence, 88 Phillips Street. Five brothers and sisters. And when I ran for the Senate 6 years ago, I went up to 88 Phillips Street to ring the doorbell to see who lives there now on the first floor of the triple decker where my father was raised. My father's son is a United States Senator. His other two sons are lawyers. And out onto the porch came a Dominican family with their children. And the accents were different, but the aspirations clearly the same for that family as for the Markey family. Well, last September, a natural gas explosion ripped right through that whole neighborhood. And I came back 4 weeks later with a Senate hearing right there, so that all of these Dominican families, but the families in North Andover and Andover as well, who were negatively affected, would know that the United States Senate, their senator, was going to make Columbia Gas accountable. And they were not only going to fix everything, but I didn't want them to bring in old appliances. They were all getting the most efficient new appliances that were going into the homes. So they were going to be ensuring that everything they did for that community was state of the art, and everyone was made whole and even better. Okay? And I did that, yeah, not just because it's my father, not just because it's the neighborhood. You know, I'm from Lawrence. Well, I'm not from Lawrence. Your father lives where your mother tells him he's going to live. So my mother was from Malden, so he had to move to Malden, okay, from Lawrence. I had an identity with 88 Phillips Street and these people. And so you have to regulate them. They had shortchanged safety. They had compromised the integrity of that entire system. And they felt free because of the era within which they were operating, the Trump era. So we just have to make sure that in Massachusetts, we extract from our utilities the highest standards of safety, but the highest standards for energy efficiency, for solar deployment, for deploying charging stations all across our country, all across our state. They're already promising to install about 15,000 charging stations in Massachusetts for all electric vehicles by the year 2025. But I think we need a goal. I think we need a bigger goal, okay? I think we need a goal where we say, no, Massachusetts is gonna be number one. That ultimately we're gonna need 100,000 charging stations or more. And we got to just set the goal and then implement it. And then that makes it a lot easier for people to contemplate moving to an all-electric vehicle because the price is going to collapse. You know, they're going to be available, but people are going to have range anxiety, right? And it's going to take the utilities who generate the electricity to make sure that the solar panels are on the roofs, that the charging stations are there, that they're being maintained, and then that people feel very comfortable then in buying the all-electric vehicles, right? So it's all going to be part of a package, and you're going to go into the dealership, and you're going to be able to do that, and the utility is going to be partnered. So we have to just set the regulations and ensure that that happens. And I think we can do that here in Massachusetts. I think we can be the leader. I think that we can set the standard that the rest of the country looks at. We're usually in a competition with California on everything. This should be one where we beat them, okay? Even though we're not the perfectly sunny state, we're really the perfect storm state, that we're already, we're number seven in America in solar deployment. Massachusetts is number seven. And even at number seven, we're not happy with ourselves. At the 4th, 8th, and 10th grades, we're number one in math, verbal, and science at the 4th, 8th, and 10th grades, and we're still not happy with the school system. That's who we are. We're Massachusetts. We're a special place. And so I agree with you, okay, that the utilities must do better. Columbia Gas, it was a disgrace. It was an absolute disgrace. And we have to stop what they're trying to do in Weymouth. We have to stop what they're trying to do in other parts of the state and just stand up. And if you need any help on any of those projects, just call me. I'll be there with you. I'll stand with you to make sure that we move towards the Green New Deal for Massachusetts, that we're the best in the country. So thank you, sir, very, very much. So where are we, Christine?
We have time for two more questions.
Two more questions, and then we'll call it a night. Just two more questions.
Okay, yes. So Kevin W. from Somerville and Stefano from Somerville.
Okay, so please come up.
Come on up.
If you're here.
I can also call Carmen from Somerville.
Okay, we'll take one. We'll take Carmen's question from Somerville. If you're here, Carmen, please come up. This will be the last question of the night. Please come up, Carmen. Okay, please, Carly.
Thank you. So just a bit of background. I've worked with EPA teams over the last 25 years on community-based programs, how to support environmental justice, community problem-solving grants, watershed grants, et cetera. How will you work in kind of investment into a Green New Deal that explicitly tries to build the civic capacity of communities to manage those parts of these changes that are going to really impact
Okay, so expand on what you would like to see happen.
Sorry?
Expand on what you would like to see happen.
Well, I mean, a really great EPA would have more staff working with communities, would have environmental justice, community problem-solving grants, watershed grants that go out either to community groups or to local partnerships or with professional groups that know how to work with communities mm-hmm. so that they because one of the challenges, I think, and I'll stop, of the Green New Deal is a lot of people will perceive it, and perhaps rightly, as too technocratic, top-down, et cetera, rather than responding to community, real genuine community engagement. I know that's not what you mean. I just want to see where the
right.
money...
No, well, actually, yeah. we write that into the Green New
Great.
Deal.
Yeah.
We talk about the help that we'd have to give to local communities. We talk about the help that we would have to give to local groups. Okay, it's actually written into the Green New Deal. And that's all part of the intersectionality. That's all part of the community-based solution that we're going to need. So we actually write that in, and I agree with you that still a lot of the communities will need technical help. So we need like an EPA ombudsman program where they can go out and help the communities to do it, help individuals to be able to accomplish their goals, but do it at the Department of Education, do it at Health and Human Services, do it everywhere across the board so that we build the capacity to be able to, again, telescope the time frame that we can get all of this done. And it just requires, though, putting I'll give you one final example. When I was the author of the 1996 Telecommunications Act, not one home in America had broadband. When President Clinton signed my bill in February of 1996, not one home in America had broadband. Hard for a kid today to believe there ever was such a day. But what I built into the law was this, because I'm from Malden, I built in a program which has now spent $54 billion. And what's that money used for? That's what pays for the internet bill for kids in Somerville on their desk, in Malden, in Roxbury, in Chelsea. So that there's a federal program that says we'll help defray the cost. We know that Lexington really doesn't need that much help, or Wellesley. So it's a 90% payment here, only 10%, 20% in Lexington or Newton. So you need a plan, in other words. You can see a revolution's coming. We're gonna have a broadband deployment across our whole country. We don't wanna leave behind kids or communities that aren't rich, don't have all those resources. So it's important to look ahead and lead the way. And that's why broadband technology in schools was deployed for the first time by any technology for poor children as fast as for wealthy children, because it was a plan, and I built it in, and it's $54 billion already. We're gonna have to do that as part of the Green New Deal. We're gonna have to make sure that the federal agencies, that the programs that are there, filter right down to the local level, and that there's a partnership that is created. So I thank you, sir, so much.
Great.
And
thank you.
I thank all of you for being here tonight. I thank you for,
Can you mention the show?
The show? Oh, yeah. Yes, sir. I'm sorry. Yes, sir. Who I did.
I did not know you had to write a question, but I do have a question for you. My name's Thomas Dick, and I'm from Melrose. And there's a lot of respect in this country for our military.
Yeah.
And I would ask, you know, for you guys to emphasize how dire and how important this climate thing is.
Okay, good.
Have you guys ever got these admirals and generals, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, in an open hearing and ask them so that they can explain to the American people how serious this is? Ask them what's going to happen to Norfolk. You know, a major naval base is going to be
in Virginia,
underwater.
Yes, in Virginia.
But this is it's kind of theater, but Trump is theater. And a lot of Americans do not really, I don't think, really realize how serious it is. And then my second point is, you know, when you debate Kennedy next week, ask him if he's divested.
No. So I'm going to take your question. So Nancy Pelosi in 2007 created a committee to deal with the climate crisis and asked me to be the chair. And she asked me then to put together the policies which we would implement and pass out of the Democratic House of Representatives. That's where the fuel economy standard law came from that Obama used to go to 54.5 miles per gallon along with the California Clean Air Waiver. That's where the Waxman-Markey bill passed in 2009 to reduce greenhouse gases by 80% by the year 2050 that McConnell then killed in the Senate that year. So I was the chair. But I had to figure out, what's my first hearing? What's the first hearing that I'll have there? In 2007, the beginning of 2007. Well, yeah, I want Carl Pope, the head of the Sierra Club, to testify in that first panel. Yeah, I want Jim Woolsey, who used to be the head of the CIA, who's then by then like the biggest advocate for all electric vehicles. Yes, I want Richard Haass, who's the head of the Council on Foreign Relations, to testify on that first panel. But who's my first witness? And so a couple months before that hearing, General Gordon Sullivan from Massachusetts, who had been the Army General and the Joint Chiefs of Staff, had put together a group of 12 three- and four-star admirals to begin to say that climate change is a threat multiplier for our national security across the country. And so I had him testify first, my very first witness and my very first hearing. And I thought, well, he'll look at all the Republicans. He'll be testifying for all the three- and four-star generals. He'll be talking about the Norfolk Naval Station. He'll be talking about these bases around the country that are increasingly vulnerable. And they'll respond, because it won't be a bunch of granola-chomping tree-huggers. It'll be generals who are testifying. So he told the story. And here's the story he told. That he was the general in Somalia, during Black Hawk Down, you know the movie I'm talking about. And he had to make the decision to send in our military that wound up in that incredible firefight in Mogadishu. And it's traumatic, he said, to make a decision like that. Incredibly difficult decision to send in our American men and women into a situation like that. And that had happened in the early 1990s. And he had a lot of time to think about it. And so I asked him, well, where did you get the idea to think about this? He said, well, you know, I said to my wife as soon as I retired, let's go up to Vermont. I want to show you where my mother and father used to take me from Massachusetts to where the maple trees were that they would take us to during the summer, during the fall. And the maple trees weren't in that town anymore. They had moved north because they need colder weather. And I started thinking, he said. I started thinking, and then I thought about Mogadishu, and I thought about Somalia, and I came to realize that deserts had been created in Somalia because of climate change, and now different tribes were fighting over natural resources, over water, and that we were sending in relief, and they were fighting over the relief that we were sending in, and then we had to send in the military to separate these gangs who were fighting. And so he said, I'm here to testify on behalf of 12 other three- and four-star generals and admirals, just to say that climate change is a threat to our national security. And it didn't have any impact on the Republicans that day, you know, because they were working as hard as they could, you know, ultimately against the Waxman-Markey bill from becoming the law. But you're right, okay? It's going to become a larger and larger issue when our national security people say that we could wind up with upwards of 200 million climate refugees on the planet. It causes great instability, regional instability, and then the United States has to move in to solve the problem. So from my perspective, you got your finger right on it, and it's a good way to end this evening, okay? Because this issue is something that is the issue of our time. It is the national security issue. It's the healthcare issue. 90% of children on the planet right now are exposed to toxics in the air above that which is healthy. 90% of all the children on the planet. It's the economic, it's the environmental, it's the moral issue. And we have to be the leaders. We're Massachusetts. The American Revolution started right here. The abolitionist movement started right here. The suffragette movement started right here. The Affordable Care Act movement started right here. The same-sex marriage movement started right here. And the Green New Deal and our solution to the climate crisis, it will be right here. You are the revolutionaries. Thank you all so much for coming out here this evening. And ladies and gentlemen, one more. I forgot. Our great Middlesex County Sheriff, Peter Katusian, is here this evening. Where are you, Peter? Please stand up over here. Peter, thank you. What an incredible leader that Peter is. Thank you all so much. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for being here. Thank you.